Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. What a joy to welcome you, each and every one of you, to this worship service on this Easter morning. In this place where we believe that whoever you are and wherever you happen to be on your faith journey or your life journey, you are welcome here. For those of you that may have deep roots here at UUMC, to those of you who may have come into the worship service for the first time in this sanctuary, we're glad that you're here. My name is Teresa Welborn, and I'm the senior pastor here at University UMC. Again, we welcome you, and as we get started, I would invite you to find the black registration pads in your pews so that we can have a record of your attendance this day. This is especially a great way for us to hear from any guests or visitors that may be among us and are looking for more information about our church. In keeping with that, I mean, we'll note this later in the service as well. It's a little thicker of a bulletin because we have a busy spring and want to let you know about several events coming up in the life of our church. And we'll share about that more later. Certainly encourage you to take those bulletins home and learn more. But one thing I will highlight for any guests and visitors that are interested in learning more about the church, Pastor Earl and I will be in the Fellowship Hall next Sunday during the Sunday School Hour for a newcomers brunch, and we hope to see you there. Friends, let us stand as we are able, in body and or spirit, as we join together in our call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
This is the season of great joy, for Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Our opening hymn is Christ the Lord is Risen Today. It's in our hymnals number 302. Let us unite our voices together in song.
Thank you.
Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us exchange signs of Christ's peace with one another.
Some baby chicks. That's awesome. Oh, that's awesome. We got to maybe spend some time with friends and family. Yeah, so we're celebrating, huh? Does it look like we're celebrating in here? Look around. There's lots of people here. There's some bright colors, right? We changed our altar cloth. It's white. What's happening? John?
Oh, yeah, that's a good idea, John.
Yeah, we're celebrating. We're coming to the end of Lent, the 40 days and 40 nights that Jesus spent with God, spent praying, right? I have a question. Do you think he came out of that time a little bit changed? Do you think he felt a little bit different? Yeah. If you all did something for Lent, I know some friends gave up screens for Lent. Some other friends gave up stuffies. One friend gave up stuffies. Do you think they were living their lives a little bit different? Do you think they felt different by the end of it? Yeah. Well, what did we do about 40 days and 40 nights ago? I had some papers all out there. And you all went and got them and brought them back to me. And we put them in this chest. What did we do? The friends who were here. Do you remember what we did? What did we do? We buried the Alleluias. That's right. Well, today is the day. So we didn't say Alleluia, right? We didn't say it. Today's the day. We can say it. Can we say it all together? Ready? Alleluia! Nice. So those Alleluias went into our chest. And that's right. We had a few. There's a lot. But there's some in here, and they transformed. Okay? Pastor Teresa and Megan are going to come help us take them out. They look different. I want you to watch close. Let's see. What did they turn into? They come out a little different? Yeah. It's magic. Yeah. So they went, we buried them, and they came out a little more beautiful, didn't they? Yeah, that's kind of what happens to us when we get time to spend with God. Isn't that awesome? All right, are you guys ready to pray with me? Okay. Dear God, thank you for Jesus' life.
Thank you for Jesus' life.
And all the ways he taught us about love.
All the ways he taught us about love.
Help us to live.
Help us to live.
More like him.
More like him.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, friends, I will walk you all to childcare. You can follow me.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Living God, today's good news is so wondrous, so magnificent, that we struggle to wrap our heads around it. Give our hearts the wisdom to receive that which our heads cannot fully understand. Send your Spirit to fill our whole bodies with your resurrection promise. This we pray in your holy and good name. Amen. Our scripture is from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabuni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not touch me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Sandy. Friends, would you please pray with me and for me? May we pray. Loving God, we give you thanks this day for your living word, its meaning in our lives today and forevermore. And we ask in these moments now that the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Amen. Well, happy Easter. Christ is risen. I'm trusting by the feedback that you can hear me okay, even way back in the back. I'm so glad to see each and every one of you here today. And you know, it's typical for a pastor like me to look out upon you, to look up, and to want to know every single one of your names. I will look forward to meeting some of you, no doubt, after the worship service, met a few of you on your way in. But chances are, by this afternoon, I won't know all of your stories, much less all of your names. But God does. This has long been one of my favorite parts of John's Easter story. Mary, who is known by the risen Christ. Mary herself mistaking him to be the gardener, but then she hears him call her by name, Mary. And there in the Easter garden, there is recognition and awareness. I wonder, perhaps she herself could have written that old beloved hymn in the garden, and he walks with me and talks with me and tells me that I am his own. The scene from that first Easter morning carries me back to another mention of a garden, another place in the scriptures, in the creation story, for example, in that very first book of the Bible. There in Genesis, the Creator creates. And in a love that is fierce and intimate, they, there in the garden, decide to dream up humans. The Holy One, the God of all creation, knows your name. Friends, I want you to hear this good news. You are known, you are claimed, you are beloved, and we have gathered in this sanctuary to hear once again the good news of the Easter story. This is a story that is so powerful that we usually hear it better when it is sung rather than told. So I am grateful for the guest musicians and the choir and all of the singing today, but I'm going to attempt to say some things as well. We live in trying and tender times. You know that well. In times like these, I need the Easter story once again, the story of love's victory, the story that love is stronger than hate, the story that love wins. This is the promise that we hear in God's great love story that is found in the scripture. Now, it appears that these days, just about anybody can sell a Bible. But at times we wonder, I guess I'm not the only one who wonders, if they actually read the Bible. Because the Bible I read tells about a God who calls me to welcome the stranger, the immigrant. The Bible I read tells of a God who calls us, demands us to turn our swords into plowshares, our weapons of war destroyed, and to pick up instead tools that will give life. The Bible I read tells about the one who came to show us what love looks like. Jesus, whose preferential treatment was not for any one country, but instead for the poor. Jesus, who invites us to follow in his humble way of service. When I look to Jesus, I am convicted that compassion is better than hate, that peace is better than violence. But I have a confession. Because at times in a world that seems to be running low on compassion, I confess that some days I struggle. In a world where the monsters of hate and violence seem to have the upper hand, my faith that love wins seems shaky at best. Am I alone? You know, I'm not always grateful for the news that I read about, but I am grateful for courageous journalists and reporters who tell us the truth. They share with us what is going on in places throughout the world and here in our own community. Carol Guzzi is a photojournalist, and she has won multiple Pulitzer Prizes for her photography, usually her photography taken in dangerous and destabilized corners of our world. It was last spring, around this time, that Carol was writing an article describing Easter celebrations in Ukraine. One picture shows candles being lit in a church in the city of Bucha. This is the church with the well-known mass grave behind it. I was reading an article yesterday and was reminded that on this very day, March 31st, 2 years ago, that is when Russian forces finally withdrew from the city of Bucha, leaving behind hundreds of lives lost. Another picture that this photojournalist shows is in a smaller town, and it depicts women dressed in their Easter Sunday best, holding baskets that are filled with the traditional Ukrainian Easter cake. Another picture is taken of men outside of a sanctuary ringing the bells while onlookers stand in reverence. Everywhere she looked, it seemed to her that people were observing Easter. She visited one church and was present for the worship service. And she described the radiant sunlight pouring in to the sanctuary, the sound of the voices of alleluias ringing in the air. In Ukrainian, the word for Easter is Veligden, literally meaning great day. And this journalist, as she shares all these pictures of the great day being celebrated in the war-torn country, writes these words. I asked people along the way, how can you celebrate? How can you be so brave? She asked them these questions, and they said to her, we are so used to suffering. This is not the first time. She went on to reflect on all that she had witnessed and said, it is almost an act of defiance, I think, to live with such joy anyway. Friends, this is at the heart of the story that we come to hear today. A story of Easter joy. This joy does not deny the bad news. In fact, if we remember Sandy's reading of John's gospel, we hear that other disciples appeared there at the empty tomb. But the scriptures go on to say that it was Mary alone, Mary by herself, who stayed behind to weep. And it is not lost on me that the joy of Easter appears to this one who stayed behind to grieve. This Easter joy knows how to suffer. It knows what it is to suffer. This joy catches us by surprise in the midst of times that are hard and troubling. A joy that is not of our own making, but certainly a joy into which we are called to participate. Joy that is the ultimate defiance of all that is unjust and painful in our world. Some of you know the work of Brian Stevenson. Brian Stevenson is an African-American lawyer and social justice activist. He is a professor of law at New York University, and in his book, Just Mercy, he shares about his calling to the work of justice, especially in the area of racism that is embedded in our criminal justice system that incarcerates an unjust and disproportionate number of ethnic minorities. In this book and in lectures, he goes on to talk about the kind of people who change the world. Do you want to be world changers? World changers have a few key characteristics, he said. First, people who are world changers are proximate to pain. World changers move towards places of suffering. They move close to people who are going through difficult times. We cannot change the world from a distance, says Stevenson. We must instead move to places of hurt. I know this is part of why I admire our committed volunteers who come Saturday morning after Saturday morning to our Open Door and Fig Leaf Ministries. Not only do they clothe and feed our unhoused neighbors, these volunteers engage with persons who are going through hard times, and they hold holy space to hear stories of pain. World changers are willing to do uncomfortable things. This was Mary's posture on that first Easter as she went to the grave, prepared, fully prepared to encounter a dead body and all that brings up, including unpleasant smells and her own grief. World changers, said Stevenson, will also tell the truth. Like a good journalist, Mary goes forth to report and share all that she has witnessed and experienced. This day, as I consider the story of Easter embedded in a world of hope and hurt, I remember a journalist reporting on NPR earlier this year. He shared the story of a baker in Gaza who continues to bake cakes for Palestinians. His bakery was destroyed in the war, but it astounds me. He sets up shop in tents and shelters, doing what he can to bring a little joy to Gazans. Children need cheering up, reports the journalist. Birthdays come only once a year, and couples won't let a war delay their plans to wed. The baker, Abu Hani, was interviewed. He expressed his shock for the huge demand for cakes and said, "People are pushing themselves to hope," which is another trait of world changers, according to Stevenson. They work hard to guard and protect their hope, and they choose joy anyway. A closing story. The cover of your bulletin this morning is of Easter eggs. But as a few of you commenting to me before worship have already noted, you are quick to catch on. These are not your ordinary Easter eggs. You might recognize them as traditional Ukrainian Easter eggs called pisanki. Pisanki is an ancient art, and I've recently learned more about it from the ethnographer and New York artist Sofika. She is of Ukrainian descent. She has memories of sitting in her mama's lap as she learns the art and craft of pisanki. This comes literally from the word meaning to write, and in the traditional method, melted wax is used to draw or to write patterns on the eggshell before dipping it into the dye. With care and attention and a lot of patience, the process is repeated over and over and over again until a multicolored pattern is revealed. Sofika explains that the pisanki was adopted by Ukrainian Christians as a symbol for joy and hope at Easter, the great day. But hear this story, friends. The Pasanke's original story predates Christianity. There's an ancient legend from the area telling the story of a monster that was the personification of evil. It lived in the Carpathian Mountains of Ukraine. And in this story, people in the village would make pasanki. And they believed that the more pasanki they made, the tighter the chains are wrapped around the monster, keeping it at bay so that it does not destroy the world. You see, friends, when we choose joy, we are tightening the chains of evil and injustice. When we choose joy, we bear witness that peace is better than violence, that love is stronger than death. We guard our hope and we submit to the powerful surprise of the good news. Even in tender and troubling times, perhaps especially in these times, a life of joy is worth the risk. For the last few years, Sofika has been calling upon people from all around the world to send pasanki to the Ukrainian Institute of New York. There is housed a growing collection of beautifully dyed eggs that she one day hopes to send to Ukraine as a sign of new birth and hope for the future. She laments greatly for her beloved homeland, and she chooses joy. As I look out upon you this day, I can't know all the stories that you yourself carry. Beyond the world's news, no doubt some of you are carrying hard and heavy things in your personal and interior lives. I don't know all your stories, but I know that God does. And what I know without a shadow of a doubt is that God's great desire for you is joy. You yourself might find joy in dyeing beautiful Easter eggs. My sense is that maybe not all of you find joy in doing that. But there are a thousand ways to choose joy this day. Create something, bake a cake, use the good china on a so-called ordinary day, volunteer for a cause that makes your heart race, sit with someone who finds it difficult to hope, plan the party, take the trip. Like Mary, allow yourself to move towards the place of suffering, and then see what God can do. Amen.
Thank you. Now let us gather our hearts and minds and enter the presence of our God in our prayer. Let us pray. On this Easter morning, we welcome you, Jesus, into our lives. We welcome your resurrection because it tells us that the sacred seed of your life-giving love can always sprout and grow, even from the ruins of death. We welcome your resurrection not because it gives us a simple promise of otherworldly escape, but because it teaches us why we can still continue the work of resurrection in this world, in nurturing life, in growing peace, in seeking justice, although it demands time and patience. Creator Divine, revive a compassionate heart in us today. Through us, may the light of resurrection reach the hearts of those who feel lifeless, those who have had the death of the loved one, and those who are mired in despair and distress. May your resurrection illuminate the sacred pathway to hope, that they may discover the glimmers of new life on the horizons of their wilderness. Love incarnate, renew our spirit to be the living proof of your love today. We hold in tenderness and prayer the collective suffering of our world at this time. We grieve precious lives lost, vulnerable lives threatened everywhere. Through us, may your love change the world even a bit. May your love resurrect the deep root of our spirit in your persistent presence so that we may resist the power that thrives at the sacrifice of life and reject the power that prevails by feeding on fear. Giver of life, restore Easter joy in us today. Through us, may the story of grief becoming joy spread. May all of us find the possibilities of new life blooming even at the graveside and dead ends of our lives. May all of us know that because you live, even the worst things the world can throw at us are no match for the love that sustains us through each step of our lives, now and in the ones to come. As we ask these things in your name, we also want to pray the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now let us offer our hearts and our gifts to God. And this is a simple reminder that if you finish writing your registration card, this is the time you can place them in the offering plates. Thank you. Ushers may come forward.
Oh, okay.
We stand as we are able and join together in our prayer of dedication. With joyful hearts, we offer ourselves and our gifts to God.
May our offerings bless those who are in need, who hurt, and who seek help.
Friends, I give thanks today because of your generosity. Our children's ministry programs continue to thrive here at UUMC. And I want to let you know about our upcoming vacation church camp that is made possible because of your gifts. It is called Greetings from Wesley Falls, and we have some of these handouts following the worship service. You lifelong Methodists will recognize that as a play off of our founder, John Wesley. But this is a place where children will come to learn about what it means to be compassionate and kind, grounded in Wesleyan theology. And we're grateful because your gifts and your presence and your volunteering hours enable us to teach our young people. So for all of our gifts, we give God thanks.
May our offerings be signs of your gifts to the whole world, bringing healing and reconciliation.
Friends, your invitation today is to remember about the newcomers brunch next Sunday, and information is in here. And also next week we have a really exciting worship service. It's Bluegrass Sunday, and you definitely do not want to miss that. It is so much fun. Friends, there is lots of really good stuff in this bulletin for every age group and every person. And so I invite you to look at the rest of this and check out the cool stuff coming to UMC in the coming weeks and months. Also, if you are a college student, we are having dinner and we're watching the greatest movie of all time, Jesus Christ Superstar, tonight. So if you're a college student and you would like to join us, I'm having dinner. We're going to have Easter candy and Jesus Christ Superstar. So please join us for that. You can ask me if you have any questions. Also, if you would like to take a lovely Easter photo, some of our friends, Natasha and Jillian, have made a wonderful arch out here. If you go out this way to the courtyard, there's a beautiful flower arch, and you can take really great family pictures out there. So you should totally do that after the service. Friends, thank you so much for coming today. It was so good to have you say Happy Easter. And would you please turn to 308 for our closing hymn?
Thank you.
again for being in worship with us today. Again, I want to know all of your names. So I do hope that you would come through these doors to the courtyard. As Megan shared, there's a photo booth. And one of the things about this church is we have good bottle sticker swag. And so we have lots of new stickers with our logos like Blessed Are Those Who Resist and Do All the Good and Y'all Means All. So we have a new shipment of those stickers, and please linger as a chance to connect and get to know one another, and we can take your picture if you want. And now as you go forth, I want you to hear these words. We do go forth into a world that is hurting, that is hungry for hope. And so as people who seek to change the world, I want to leave with you these words from African-American theologian Howard Thurman, who said, "Do not ask what the world needs. Ask instead what makes you come alive, and then go forth and do it. Because what the world needs is people who are alive. This is what it means to practice resurrection. This is what it means to choose joy." Amen.